Second, al-jins, kind. If someone wanted to sacrifice a horse, can he? No, he cannot. In Eid al-Adha, can you sacrifice a horse? No, we have stipulation as what to. So the kind of the kind will have will make a difference whether it's from the Sunnah or the Bidah. Even though sacrificing for the sake of Allah is an act of worship, if the kind is not in harmony with the Sunnah, you're doing a Bidah. Thirdly, al-Qadr, the quantity, the amount. Can you pray Dhuhr 5 rak'at? Tell that to the Mubtadi'. Say, you know, you're saying, you know, more dhikr of Allah. Come on, man, 5 is good. 4 is, Allah deserves more than 5. Do 20. Pray Dhuhr 20. Why don't you pray Dhuhr 20? I mean, more. Say, look, if you're not, the amount, not with the Sunnah, you're a Mubtadi'. Even though you're worshipping Allah, even though you think you're getting closer to Allah, Allah will not accept it. Fourthly, kayfiyah, the manner. If somebody wants to do wudu, he says Bismillah, then he puts his foot in the sink. Can you do that? Then after you wash your feet, you clean your ears, and then after you don't want to do that. Even the Sunnah, by the way, is so, the revelation is so precise as to keep you protected from diseases and bacteria. Imagine if you wash your feet before you goggle and put water in your mouth. That's not going to be very nice. But the way you clean yourself, by the way, is in such a fashion where everything is in harmony. So the kayfiyya, the manner. Fifthly, al-zaman. Can you, for example, sacrifice on the first day of Dhul Hijjah? No, you have to wait for the day of Nahr. So the time has to be in agreement with the Sunnah. And lastly, al-makan, the place. You have to, for example, can you do i'tikaf at home? No. I'tikaf is in the masjid. These are the 6 ways. Every time you want to worship Allah, make sure that you are in harmony with the Sunnah in these 6 kinds. If you have one of them missing, leave it alone. It is better for you to avoid doing something that you're not sure is a Sunnah than doing it and being an innovator. It is better for you to leave it alone. So, in finality, let me give you a couple of ayat which should put an end to this. Allah says in the Quran, اتبعوا ما أنزل إليكم من ربكم ولا تتبعوا من دونه أولياء قليلا ما تذكرون. Follow what was sent down to you from your Lord, and do not follow other allies, other friends, other protectors besides Allah. Little do you remember. Follow what Allah revealed. Don't go anywhere else. فلا وربك لا يؤمنون حتى يحكموك فيما شجر بينهم ثم لا يجدوا في أنفسهم حرجا مما قضيت ويسلموا تسليما. Nay, by your Lord, they shall not believe until they make you a judge concerning everything they dispute about. Then they find no discomfort in their heart concerning what you judge, and they submit in full submission. Once you accept the Sunnah blindly, then and only then you have Iman. Once you want to put your mind into it, then you don't have perfect Iman. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَعْشُ عَنْ ذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَنِ نُقَيِّدْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِينٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ لَيَصُدُّونَهُمْ عَنِ السَّبِيلِ وَيَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. Whosoever turns away from the remembrance of the Most Merciful, the Quran and the Sunnah, we will assign for him a devil, and he will be his close companion. Then Allah says, وَإِنَّهُمْ, and verily, without a doubt, they will be misleading them from the path while they think that they are rightly guided. And this is the condition of every innovator today. He does not think he's wrong. He thinks he's dead right, and you dead wrong. He thinks he's upon the Sunnah, and wallahi, he's upon the Bid'ah. But just as Allah said, when they turn away from the Quran and the Sunnah and the understanding of the Salaf, the consequence is that Allah will give him a shaitan, he will lead him astray, and they think that they're going straight to Jannah. Subhanallah al-Azim. وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَى وَيَتَّبِعَ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّى وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمُ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Whosoever opposes the messenger after the truth and the guidance has become clear and manifest and follows a path other than that of the believers, we will allow him to take that path, then we will make him enter Jahannam, and what an evil abode. If you oppose the messenger after the Sunnah became clear to you, and you follow other than the way of the Sahaba, who were the mu'mineen when this ayah was revealed? The Sahaba. If you follow other their way, Allah will let you take that way, but Allah will take you to Jahannam eventually. And the ayat are many, but I don't want to take any longer. The idea, my brothers and sisters in Islam, the Muslim ummah is suffering a lot from innovators and innovations. And until we clean this deen up, from these people and their practices, and our intent and hope from Allah is that the practices will be cleansed and the people will become among the sunnah. Now, we don't want to lose any Muslim. We wish good for every Muslim. We hate the bid'ah, but we wish good for every Muslim, even if he's falling into bid'ah. We want him to leave the bid'ah, otherwise we wouldn't give him da'wah. But until we do so, the ummah will not be sound. The ummah will not be, the honor, the reign of the Islamic ummah will not be acquired until we clean our deen and we raise the generation upon the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's an obligation on every one of us to learn the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah and to know what innovations are and to warn against them and to act as propagators against the bid'ah and for the sunnah. If every one of us played his role, then we can make a major difference in the community. وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد. Any questions?
I was in Malaysia a couple years ago, and after every prayer, almost all prayers, there's a dua. What are you supposed to just walk out?
Walk out, baby. Out the door. See you later. Or deliberately, in their face, sit there and say, Subhanallah, 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 Subhanallah. Say the dhikr after salah, forget about these people. You advise the imam. And if you have the means to give a lecture and to advise him, stand up after salah, say, Ya jama'at al khair, barakallah feekum, wallahi, this is not from the sunnah. Then do so. But if you don't have the means, don't participate. Look, how many times did the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, lead the sahaba in salah? Allahu a'lam how many times. Not once, not even once, regardless of the occasion and the situation, he raised his hands after the salah and everyone raised their hands and they said a congregational dua with a ameen. Not even once. If Allah loved it, if that dua would be accepted by Allah, this is the right time for the dua, the Messenger of Allah would have done it or taught it or approved it. None of these happen, it's a bid'ah. Even if the biggest Mawlana in the world does it, and his turban is from here to Chinatown, it's still a bid'ah. And we don't do it. We advise the people, we don't do it. The sunnah is you remember Allah and you go home. Pray the sunnah at home. Aywa. The subha, let me be clear, let me be honest. The beads, there's a difference of opinion among the ulama, just so you know. Some of the ulama of sunnah say it's not a bid'ah. They say it's just a wasila. It means for you to remember Allah. It's not an act of worship. But I read some very interesting statements of one of the mashayikh elaborating on this issue and actually deducing the ruling from this hadith recorded of Ibn Mas'ud that really left me with the clear understanding that it's a bid'ah. Because it's the same thing. He said, what's the difference whether you have 100 pebbles that are in a bucket or you have them in a thread? He said, it's the same thing. Ibn Mas'ud didn't like it. He didn't approve it. He rejected it. It's a bid'ah. Al-anam al-mustantaqa. Prophet ﷺ said to one of his wives, remember Allah with your fingers. These fingers will speak. They will testify on the day of judgment. So the sunnah is that you count on your fingers. Subhanallah, 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 subhanallah. Some say that like that. Some say like this. Subhanallah, subhanallah, subhanallah. It doesn't matter now. The scholars have differed on how to do it. But the fingers will testify. So the Prophet ﷺ used to count the tasbih on his fingers. He didn't use beads, even though they could have. We do the same thing.
What about holding a mushaf in Tarawih? I've seen people do it in Makkah.
The imam or the ma'moom?
The people who are standing behind. This is for better understanding and they can follow.
We've discussed in the lectures in Ramadan that this is not from the sunnah for the ma'moom to carry the Quran. It negates the nature of the salah. Your job in the salah is to put your right hand on your left. On your chest, not below your waist. But that's another discussion. On your chest, and to listen to the imam. How are you going to open a Quran? Flip through the pages, you know, reading. An imam may cough, he may faint, something may happen to him. What are you going to do? Continue reading? So now you have detached yourself from the imam. So a lot of movements. Then at the time of ruku, what do? Under your armpit, in your pocket. You come listen to the Quran. You love the Quran so much, mashallah, or some people try to, you know, they're too lazy. You know, they say, okay, either Taraweeh or Risal in the Quran, why don't I do it together? So when they go home, they can just eat, and they no longer have to read the Quran. No, at the time of Taraweeh, pray Taraweeh. When you're done, read the Quran. Don't do them at the same time. Wallahu a'lam. Naam.
He's leading the new Muslim in saying Talbiyah, Bid'ah.
No. Whenever you are teaching someone something, then it is allowed for you to do it according to need though. So if you take a new Muslim Surah Umrah, and they don't know how to say labbaik Allahumma labbaik, you say, I'm going to say labbaik, you say after me until you have learned it. Once you have learned it, everyone says it on his own. Hey, Hasant, good question. Anyone else?
Yeah, when I was in India, I saw the same thing people are reading there, and I said them, this is Bidah. So they said that we are Hanafi. So was this taught by Imam Abu Hanifa?
I believe if Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah came across most of the Hanafis of today, he will beat him up. He will not be pleased the least bit. He made it clear. He said, it's haram for you to imitate me if you don't know what my dalil is. And many of the so-called ahnaf today have nothing to do with Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah. It's the later fuqaha of the Hanafi madhab from various countries with various Diobandi, Aqidah, Ash'ari Aqidah, and Maturidi, and all this was not of that of Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, who understand a special fiqh now, and then they come up with all these bid'ah, and every time you sell them something, they say Hanafi, Hanafi. La, Habibi. Imam Abu Hanifa wasn't a mubtadi' like you. So that's not a valid excuse. That's not an excuse. Even if he taught that, let's assume that this was from his own statement, not the teachers of his madhab. Tell him, do you oppose the Messenger of Allah and follow Imam Abu Hanifa? Who's your Imam? The Messenger of Allah. So this is hawa. People of desire is very difficult to deal with. You should see what we suffer in the emails. Wallahi, ya Shaykh, I don't believe the emails. Wallahi, I don't believe. Can you imagine a Muslima says, do not quote Quran and Sunnah. Only give me logic and common sense. What am I going to say to this lady? A lady, this is a lady, supposedly. Don't quote Quran and Sunnah. You Wahhabis, you twist, copy and paste, cut and paste the Quran and the Sunnah. Now you guys are play chess with the deen. Don't give me Quran and Sunnah, just give me logic. If I don't give you the Quran and Sunnah, what am I, a philosopher sitting here debating with another philosopher? And that's all I have is the Quran and Sunnah. Some Muslims are so wild, they have lost this basic concept. Everything is intellect, even though they have no intellect. I mean, if they were intelligent, we would say, nas musiba. You have no brain and you want to use your brain to understand the deen. Wallah, it doesn't work. So, ma'alish, these are people of desires and intellect. You just be patient with them and give them da'wah, but this is incorrect what they told you.
If you tell your brother, tabla Allah,
bid'ah.
Like, how come in tawheed prayers, they make du'a Allahumma taqabbal siyam and wa'iqyam and ruku'a and sujood?
Just say, tab, I'll give you the same thing. Is saying, Allahumma salli wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad, good? Can you say it in the Fatiha? Can you say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Allahumma salli wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad, ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? Salah ala nabi alayhi sallam, good, very good. Because remember the kayfiyya wal makan wal sabab, it has to be in agreement with the sunnah in these six ways. So now this one, the dua in the salah with the imam is one thing, and after the salah, and saying takabbalah is a whole other thing. The Sahaba did not do that, so you did not do that. The Sahaba said, oh Allah, taqabbal minna, so we do it. You know, the taqabbal minna term is in the Quran and the Sunnah, isn't it? In the Quran, taqabbal minna, in the Sunnah. The Prophet ﷺ made that dua, so did the Sahaba. So now the Sunnah established that. Taqabbal Allah ba'd as-salah with the handshake is something that is not from the Sunnah. We go back, Habibi. Listen to the lecture again when we're done. The niyyah is worthless if the action is a contrary to the sunnah. Everybody has good niyyah. Every mubtadi', even a mushrik has a good niyyah. Even an atheist, his niyyah is, really there's no God. Say, but that's, that niyyah is not going to get you anywhere.
One of the founders